Listening Library presents The Hatmakers, written and read by Tamzin Merchant.
Chapter 1. It was a wild and lightning-struck night, the kind of night that changes everything. Jagged forks of light ripped across the sky, and thunder rolled in tidal waves over the rooftops and spires of London. With the rain lashing down and the clouds crashing above, it felt like the whole city was under the sea. But Cordelia Hatmaker was not afraid. In her candle-lit room at the very top of Hatmaker House, she was pretending to be aboard the Jolly Bonnet. The ship was being tossed by massive waves as she staggered across the deck, really her hearthrug, fighting a howling wind.
Boom!
"Batten down those hatches, Fortescue," she yelled. "I've got to lash myself to the wheel." A tin soldier stared blankly from the mantel.
"Aye, aye, Cap'n,"
Cordelia squeaked out of the corner of her mouth.
Boom!
"Enemy fire!" Cordelia cried, seizing the back of her wooden chair and heaving. Under her hands, it became a great ship's wheel.
Boom!
A violent gust of wind blew the window open. The candle sputtered out, and Cordelia was plunged into darkness.
Boom! Boom! Boom!
Echoing up the 5 stories of Hatmaker House came the sound of somebody pounding on the front door. Cordelia scrambled down the ladder from her bedroom and galloped along the top corridor. Aunt Ariadne emerged from her chamber, wrapped in a plum-coloured velvet dressing gown. Uncle Tiberius appeared, grizzle-headed from sleep.
"Father!"
Cordelia cried, skidding past them. "My father's home!"
Boom! Boom! Boom!
Cordelia raced down the spiral staircase that twisted through the middle of Hatmaker House. She hurtled past Great Aunt Petronella, snoozing in front of the flickering lilac fire in her alchemy parlor. She rushed past the tall doors of the hat-making workshop and, deciding that sliding down the corkscrew banister would be quickest, in 3 heartbeats she reached the bottom floor. Her bare feet slapped the cold tiles of the hallway. She shook her head to chase away the dizziness and ran, in not quite a straight line because she was still a little giddy, across the wide hall to the door. White light flared across the sky as she turned the hefty key in the lock. A tall figure loomed through the pebbly window. Thunder clapped overhead as she pulled open the heavy oak door. A crack of lightning split the sky in 2. A man stood on the front step of Hatmaker House. He was drenched, ragged, and gasping in the wind. It was not her father. Chapter 2. Cordelia stumbled backwards as the man lurched through the door, bringing the rain and the unruly wind into the house with him. His rich brocade cloak smelled of sea spray and salt.
"Lord Whitloof."
It was Aunt Ariadne carrying a lantern down the stairs.
"What on earth has happened?"
Lord Whitloof was dripping a puddle of rainwater onto the hall floor.
"Alas, not earth, Madam Hatmaker, but sea," Lord Whitloof wheezed. "Something has happened at sea."
Cordelia felt as though a Siberian ice spider was crawling down her neck.
"Please, my lord, tell us what has occurred," said Uncle Tiberius.
"Has something happened to the Jolly Bonnet?"
Cook appeared in the kitchen doorway, her hair in rag rolls and a wooden spoon in her hand.
"Where is my father, Captain Hatmaker?"
Cordelia's voice was thin and quivery with fear. Lord Whitloof took the black tricorn hat off his head and tipped out a large volume of water from its brim.
"The Jolly Bonnet," he pronounced, "has been sunk. She crashed onto those ghastly rocks that guard the entrance to Rivermouth."
The wind howled through the house.
"But my father, where is he?"
Cordelia asked. The ice spider was spinning a freezing web around her insides. Lord Whitloof looked down at his boots.
"I was there, waiting at the top of the lighthouse to see that the ship was guided safely through the strait,"
he muttered, gripping his hat, knuckles white.
"The palace has been most anxious for Captain Hatmaker to return with the final ingredient for the king's new hat. But tonight..."
Lord Whitloof stopped, eyes filled with horror.
"The sail came into view through the storm," he went on, face grey. "I was close enough to hear the crew's cries on the wind, saw Captain Hatmaker himself at the wheel. But before the ship could pass the rocks to reach the safe haven of Rivermouth, a terrible wave crested from the black ocean and cast the Jolly Bonnet upon them. The ship was matchsticks in a matter of moments.
Cordelia was shaking her head. Then she realized her whole self was shaking.
All went down with the ship, Lord Whitleaf whispered. None survived.
But no, Cordelia said. My father's the best swimmer I know. He can swim through storms and whirlpools. He can't have sunk.
Lord Whitleaf looked seasick and sad.
Captain Hatmaker is lost at sea, he said. I am sorry.
Cordelia's grief and fury, stronger than her shaking legs, carried her back up the stairs. Aunt Ariadne's voice was a ragged flag fluttering behind her. A treacherous tide of tears swelled in her eyes as she felt her way along the top corridor. She wrenched open the door at the end, and the achingly familiar smell of her father broke over her. It was the smell of spices he brought back from his adventures, and cedar, and wood smoke, and sea air. Cordelia launched herself under his empty bed and buried herself in the scratchy wool blankets. She lay with her face pressed into the pillow, feeling as though the saddest song she'd ever heard was trying to burst out of her. It howled through her stomach and into her chest and wound round her heart and up into her throat where she could feel it juddering with despair.
Cordelia,
whispered Aunt Ariadne, tiptoeing into the room.
The thunder rumbled overhead. It sounded like ships crashing on rocks.
My poor Cordelia.
Cordelia lay with her whole body tense, determined not to let the sad song out of her mouth. A warm hand rested on her back. Eventually, her aunt said,
This will help you sleep, my love.
She stroked Cordelia's hair aside, and Cordelia felt the velvet of a moonbloom nightcap being pulled gently onto her head. The nightcap worked a dark purple kind of magic, and she was asleep in the space of a single sigh. Tentacles beckoned her from the deep, and she called to her father, but her voice was lost among the shapes of waves. All night long, the words, lost at sea, lost at sea, lost at sea, whispered to her in storm-tossed dreams, and an albatross keened and curled in a strange sky. In the morning, she woke with an idea. What is lost can be found.
Chapter 3.
Cordelia pulled on her father's jacket. Its gold buttons glinted in just the same way hope does. She pushed up the sleeves and padded out of the room. Hatmaker House was quiet. Through the window, the sky was a clean blue, and the raindrops that speckled the windows glowed in the rays of pale yellow sunlight. The library smelled of beeswax and polished wood and Turkish carpet. Thousands of books stood shoulder to shoulder on the shelves, ancient grimoires, guides to new sciences, and tomes full of eldritch secrets all jostled for space. Some were taller than Cordelia's knees, with ridged leather spines. Others were smaller than the palm of her hand and bound in jewel-coloured silk. They were all the kind of book whose pages whispered when she turned them. It was so early that the quest pigeons still dozed in their aviary beside the window, heads tucked under their wings.
Coo-coo,
Cordelia hooted in a low voice. Several bright black eyes blinked at her as she filled their tray with new seeds and poured fresh water into their dish. She looked at one bird in particular.
Agatha, she said, my father is lost at sea and you're the only one who can find him.
Agatha flurried her wings importantly and cooed. Cordelia's father, Captain Prospero Hatmaker, had hatched Agatha himself, keeping her, as an egg, warm in his armpit. One day she pecked her way out of her shell to find herself cupped in his gentle hand and decided he was the perfect mother. When a quest pigeon is hatched this way, they will always fly to their mother wherever they are in the world to bring a message home. So Cordelia took a tiny scroll of paper from the top drawer of the desk and wrote,
Father, they say you're lost at sea. If you are lost, you can be found. Please find yourself at sea as soon as you can.
There was hardly any room left on the scroll, so she crammed in,
And please come home. Love, Dilly.
She kissed the paper, carefully, so she would not smudge the ink, and waved it in the air to dry. Then she rolled the scroll up tight and sealed it in a minuscule glass bottle with a cork and red wax. She lifted Agatha gently out of the aviary and tied the bottle to the bird's leg. She could feel Agatha's little heart pattering triple time.
To Prospero, to Prospero, Cordelia whispered like a spell. She threw the window wide and Agatha took flight. Cordelia leaned out, watching until the bird was...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.